Morning and welcome to worship at First United Methodist Church of Ferndale. It is the third Sunday of Advent, traditionally a Sunday of joy. We're grateful for joy wherever we find it in this world. Our liturgist today is Rick Churchill, and he'll be providing his portions from home, and we're grateful for his work. Mary and Bob Lenaway will be lighting the Advent candle for us, and they've sent that in from the Carolinas. So we're grateful for the technology that allows us to do those things. Our Fair Trade pop-up shop is still open online. You can find the information on our website or on our, actually find it on our Facebook page. And you can still maybe get some things in time for Christmas. I don't know. Give it a try. Our online Bible study is on Thursday. We're studying 1 Kings chapters 11 and 12, plus Ecclesiastes chapter 3, and that'll be our last study for this year. We'll begin again on January 7th. You're welcome to join us at any time. I want to thank you for your ongoing gifts, your support of the congregation as we continue to do what we believe God has called us to do, and that is to worship online and be in touch with each other in other ways. So thank you for continuing to send in your support. We appreciate it, and support to our regular ongoing expenses as well as to our help fund. People's lives are touched. Our Christmas services are coming up, and we'll have more information out about those shortly. For now, we're ready to begin our worship. John the Baptizer appears in the Gospel of John, not the same John, but John the Baptizer appears to prepare the way for the one who's coming after him. And Isaiah, in this portion today, sees better days ahead if the people persist in pursuing justice. Let's begin worship. Thank you.
Please join me in the greeting from the Psalm 126, Joy in Restoration. The Lord has done great things for us, and we rejoiced. May those who sow in tears reap with shouts of joy. Please join me in the opening prayer. God of past, present, and future faithfulness, you call us in many ways, just as you called prophets and people of old. Sometimes they felt ready for your call, and often they did not. Sometimes they were certain, and often they were shaken. Sometimes people listened, as when they streamed to John the Baptizer. But there will always be those who demand an answer that suits them, an excuse to do as they choose. Sometimes they are us. On this day, devoted to joy, show us how to hold to you, even when questions come. Show us how to remain glad in you, even when our confidence in ourselves gives way to doubt. In the name of the one who makes us who we are and loves us. Amen.
This is shadows of sadness and families and home shelters. people in prison, people who have become invisible and forgotten.
When I look around, I see shadows of grief and loss. People dreading the holidays because they've lost a loved one, because they've recently divorced, because they don't want to spend another Christmas alone.
In the face of sadness, we light the candle of joy.
In the face of grief, in the face of loss, we light a candle of joy.
May the light from this candle overwhelm the world.
May the light from this candle say to all that God's joy is coming on earth as it already is in heaven.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, be not afraid. God's joy is at hand.
Hi, kids. Good to talk to you again today. I hope sometime next year we'll be able to see each other face to face again. And maybe on Christmas Eve, if the weather's good, we can see each other outside if you're around. Anyway, but I wanted to talk about what it feels like to know that we're important. We'd like to be the most important person in the room, probably, wherever we are. It's great to feel important and be the most important, but sometimes we're not. Sometimes we're not the most important. There was a guy in the Bible by the name of John the Baptizer. The Baptizer was what he did. He went around baptizing people in a dirty river, but he told people, I'm not the most important one. There's somebody coming after me who's going to be the most important one, but I'm here to prepare the way for him. Now, he was talking about Jesus, and he wanted to get everybody ready for when Jesus came. Now, John himself was a very important person. He was very important, and a lot of people knew him, and people knew about him, and people flocked from all over the countryside to come and hear him talk and to hear his message. And it was an important message too. He had important things to do with his life, but he felt like the most important thing he could do would be to point away from himself to somebody else. He was pointing toward Jesus. He called Jesus the light that's coming into the world. And so even though it feels really good to be important, and we are important. We're definitely important to God, and we're important to all of the people around us who love us, and we're important, whether we know it or not, to the whole world. But sometimes it's better to point to someone else, especially to Jesus, I suppose, and say, he's the most important of all. And so if we're able to point towards somebody else and make them shine and make them happy and feel good, that's a good thing to do. And especially if we point to Jesus and tell people Jesus is the most important of all, then I think we've done the best thing we could possibly do to get ready for Christmas. It's coming, not too much longer now. Let's pray. Thank you, Jesus, for coming to be with us. And thank you for people like John, who, important, yes, they were so important, but John pointed the way to you. And so, thank you for coming to be born one of us here in this world. And thank you for people that prepared the way for you, whether they were shepherds or wise men or John, who called people to get ready for you coming. Help us to always be ready and getting ready, and so we'll be ready for when your special day comes. Amen.
Today I'll be reading from the Revised Standard Version. This particular Bible I received when I was in the third grade from this church. The reading for today comes from Isaiah chapter 61, verses 1 through 4 and verses 8 through 11. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to bring good tidings to the afflicted. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to those who are bound, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to grant to those who mourn in Zion, to give them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a faint spirit, that they may be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he may be glorified. They shall build up the ancient ruins. They shall raise up the former devastations. They shall repair the ruined cities, the devastations of many generations. For I, the Lord, love justice. I hate robbery and wrong. I will faithfully give them their recompose, and I will make an everlasting covenant with them. Their descendants shall be known among the nations, and their offspring in the midst of the peoples. All who see them shall acknowledge them, that they are people whom the Lord has blessed. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall exult in my God. For he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decks himself with a garland, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. For as the earth brings forth its shoots, and as a garden causes what is sown in it to spring up, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring forth before all the nations.
Thank you.
Lord from the Gospel according to John, chapter 1. Some select verses that refer specifically to the messenger John the Baptizer. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. Then moving down to verse 19, this is the testimony given by John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" He confessed and did not deny it, but confessed, "I'm not the Messiah." And they asked him, "Well, what then? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I'm not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Then they said to him, "Who are you? Let us have an answer for those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" He said, "I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord.' As the prophet Isaiah said." Now, they had been sent from the Pharisees. They asked him, "Why then are you baptizing if you are neither the Messiah nor Elijah nor the prophet?" And John answered them, "I baptize with water, but among you stands one whom you do not know, the one who is coming after me, and I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandal." And this took place in Bethany, across the Jordan, where John was baptizing. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Pastor James Howell reminds us that we have never seen a John the Baptizer Christmas card. I think we know why that is. In all four of the Gospels, John's message is one that asks hard questions, and these are questions that we often need to answer for ourselves. They ask hard questions, and in this particular case, the hard questions come to us from the mouths of the representatives of the Pharisees. A woman was one time, she found herself standing alone, well, almost alone in an elevator with one other person, and the other person in that elevator was the famous and very handsome Robert Redford in those days. As the elevator moved up through the floors, this woman became more and more nervous, like many of us might be. She found herself just staring at Robert Redford there. And finally, in her nervousness and in her excitement, she just blurted out, "Are you the real Robert Redford?" And he answered, "Only when I'm alone." So, when we're alone, maybe in the dark, maybe lying in bed, that's a question that's worth asking, even if we don't ask it of ourselves very often. Who are you? Who are you? That's what they ask John the Baptizer. That's what they ask us, and they catch us off guard, I suppose. Or maybe in our honest moments, we might even ask that question of ourselves. Who are you? So what's the answer? The first response to who are you is, who's asking? These particular askers in this passage aren't friends to John, and they aren't just curious. They're asking for another reason. What do they mean by, who are you? And what they probably mean is, what gives you the right? What gives you the right to sound so high and mighty? What gives you the right to criticize the authorities? What gives you the right? Who do you think you are, a prophet or something? The last of them died a few hundred years ago. What gives you the right? Who do you think you are, John, to preach controversial stuff around here? Who do you think you are, preacher? After all, we could say back across the centuries, who do you think you are, preacher? We live in the USA, the United States of America, and this is a United Methodist Church. We need to get together. We need to be one in spirit. And then we, of course, follow that up by asking, how long has it been since that has been true? If ever. And yes, according to the scriptures, at least one of them, we are, as much as lies within us, to live at peace with all people. But Jesus also proclaimed in his early ministry that he would be a divider of people. And so we try to live at peace, we really do, but there are divisions, and we have to face that. The divide comes when the question, who are you, means what gives you the right? Rather than who are you, I really want to understand you and what you believe and what makes you tick. Those are two different ways of looking at who are you. Because stopping our ears before opening our mouths divides us. We say things without really hearing each other. So even if those who ask the question here are looking for trouble or excuses, the question itself is still a good one. Who are you? And an honest answer means we look inside us before we open our mouth to speak. When we look inside for an answer to who are you, sometimes it can really shake us. Because as we ask ourselves, who are you? That answer comes again and again, but it changes again and again also over the years. The answer that shaped us when we were young, who are you, won't necessarily do for us when we are older. Who are you changes with the years. And some say, who they were shaped or misshaped by the faith of their childhood, and they were in fact broken by it, damaged by it, and had to leave it behind. I grew up in a faith that to some people would be considered borderline heretical, and I did leave that kind of thinking. But I was given a love for the Bible that stayed with me throughout my lifetime. And the Bible led me in a different direction from that childhood faith, and there's nothing wrong with that. Some of us in that childhood faith of ours learned some kind of a rigid perfectionism, and we learned fear and not freedom. We might have even learned how to tithe our income, but not be a generous person. We might have learned to be dishonest in our communication for fear we would sound unspiritual in the things that we say. So we talk to people, but how often do we really and truly have a genuine conversation that's honest? We've learned how to live with the weight of the shoulds and oughts weighing us down, but haven't necessarily learned to love with all of our hearts. We want to. I believe we try to. Sometimes we succeed. For some of us, we've had just a lifetime of trying to stay in control and holding things under to try to overcome, and overcoming that, pushing things down or holding things under is harmful to us. And sometimes it takes the better part of a lifetime to let that go. So if you felt that pressure to do the shoulds and oughts, pressure to fear but not to freedom, then we understand each other. We understand. So who am I? That's the question. That's what they asked John. Who are you? Who are you? We're only just learning, and maybe it's not too late for any of us to keep on learning who we are as we change through the years. And who, I have to ask myself, who will I be in a couple of years when I won't be preaching or pastoring regularly? That's a big question on me. I actually went to a therapist, and he said, you know, you've got possibly even another 25 years to plan on. You better figure out what you're going to do with those years. Who am I without my role? Who are any of us without the role that we play in our lives? We might ask. Who would I be if I lost my health? Who would I be if, in my later years, as happens to so many, I began to suffer from dementia? I couldn't remember. Who are any of us when we find ourselves alone after years of living in partnership with another person? Who are we then? These are the times when we ask again, who am I? John asked that even later on when he was in prison. He had questioned his own mission in life and had to ask again, who am I? John the Baptizer, though, first in this particular text, answers the question by saying who he is not. He says, I'm not the Messiah. I'm not Elijah. I'm not the prophet. And maybe that is that who we are? I'm not a Republican. I'm not a Democrat. I'm not a liberal. I'm not a conservative. Do we define ourselves by what we are not? I'm not that kind of Christian, whatever that kind of Christian is. I'm not this. I'm not that. Is that what we say to who we are? But John doesn't stop with what he's not. He says also, I'm a voice, and just one voice, but I'm a voice crying out in the wilderness. And we forget that even when the Gospel of John was written, toward the very end of the first century of our common era, that this gospel writer was reminding people that John the Baptizer, during their lifetimes, was better known in the Middle East than Jesus was. Not only during their lifetimes, but even for years afterwards, John the Baptizer had his own group of disciples, even after he was dead, that followed in his footsteps. So when John says, that he's just one voice, the writer of John's gospel wants us to know that John was being humble and honest and knew himself on the inside. He was willing to step down. A minister by the name of Chris Kuhn writes, during Advent, I struggle to keep track of who I am. I get waylaid by secular shininess and burdened by my own expectations. And then he goes on, it's a saving grace to read about a man who probably didn't spend hours figuring out his mission or his vision or his core values or his purpose. Or maybe he did, but whatever he discovered, whatever he discovered out there in the desert, he knew it to his core. and he wasn't afraid to express it. I think he's right on target with those words. Can we be that kind of person? Maybe not today, but someday. Someone who truly helps people around us to see the real, because we've become real on the inside over the years. There's an old story about in the old days, in the 1800s, a scrub woman would regularly attend the lectures of that most famous lecturer of that era, Ralph Waldo Emerson. Emerson was a great humanist and a great lecturer, and people, all kinds of people flocked to hear him. And someone once asked this washerwoman, this scrub woman, if she understood what Ralph Waldo Emerson was saying when he spoke and what she heard. And she answered, "Not a word of it. But I like to go and see him stand up there and look as though he thought everyone was as good as he." What a great tribute to Emerson that he could speak in that way. That everyone is as good as us, as good as, wow. So John says, he's a voice. He's just a voice, but he's at least a voice, and he knows it. He knows it, he knows who he is, and he's going to use that voice because it's what he's called to do. And then when Jesus arrives on the scene, Jesus takes Isaiah's text that Rick read earlier as the text for his very first sermon. Jesus only reads a few verses of it, but the people around him know the whole text. They know the rest. It's a passage from Isaiah that's all about justice, and that was Jesus' first message. Justice for the oppressed, justice for the beaten down, justice for the prisoners, justice for the indebted, justice for the workers. Jesus didn't choose that text for his first message by accident. And then Jesus turns and says to all of his listeners, "Today, this text becomes real for you. Comes true in your presence." Oh, and what do all of his listeners say? They say, "Who is this guy? What gives him the right?" But the message is inside Jesus, and it comes out through the words of the prophet. His message is a message of justice, of encouragement to the downtrodden, of relief for the poor, of help for those who are most in need, whatever that need might be. Now, I don't know. John heard a call, did his ministry. I don't know what God's call to you is today. Maybe you don't know it either. And maybe there isn't one today. But someday, if not today, something's going to grab you on the inside. Something's going to get inside you. Something's going to not let you go. Something's not going to let you off until you act, not let you be content with just business as usual, not going to let you be satisfied with only your routine. And we want to know it when it comes, when it grabs us, because that's another visit from Jesus. And you may follow that urging for a few moments or a few days or for a lifetime, but the fact is, it will be God reminding you of who you are and what you are called to be and do in those moments and When you know that, you can be real. Whether you're alone in the dark or not, or in broad daylight, we can be real. We can listen for God's call. Sent from God, just as John was. Witness to the light, just as John. You know, if you go down into the depths of a cave, and some of you have done this, if you had the courage or the opportunity to do so, you go down into the depths of a cave, and then when the guide turns the lights out, you're there in total darkness. Total darkness. And our eyes will never adjust, because there's nothing, there's no light there to adjust to. But if even a flickering match or a flashlight, something tiny, the tiniest beam, is lit in the darkness and the depths of that cave, our eyes will adjust and we will begin to see what's going on around us. Friends, even if all we have to offer seems like just the tiniest sliver of light, the darkness around us, even the chosen darkness that some people choose, is going to be a little bit less. And in fact, any light at all is enough to show the way a little at a time. So let's go on singing with the angels, glory to God in the highest, and peace among those whom God favors. And if we can't sing with the angels, then let's sing with each other. Come, live in the light. Shine with the joy and the love of the Lord. We are called to be light for the kingdom, to live in the freedom of the city of God. We are called to act with justice. We are called to love tenderly. We are called to serve one another, to walk humbly with God. Or maybe even sometimes we just need to sing to ourselves. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Amen. Let's pray. God, we just so rarely think of ourselves as being called, and yet we each are. Come to us, Lord Jesus, in the moments of our lives when we have real clarity and certainty and assurance of who we are. And there may be those around us who question us. There may be those around us who doubt us. There may even be those in our world around us who try to back us into a corner. But our life is in you. And Jesus is our strong companion and will come to us again and again. Be born in us today, Lord Jesus. We don't need to wait for Christmas Day. Be born in us today. Give us those opportunities to hear your call, to be your voice, just one voice, but pointing the way to the light, crying in the wilderness, but ready to obey. God, there we're very much aware of the darknesses in our world, the darkness that hovers so close. Whether it's a darkness of ignorance or a chosen darkness or whatever those darknesses may be, we pray that you will help us to live your life bravely. And on this Sunday of joy, help us to reach out again for those slivers of light, those gleams of joy that will lead us to follow you higher and better and stronger. Be with those who are hospitalized. We pray for your ongoing help for Molly Monroe as she recovers during rehab. We pray for the Neggies recovering from COVID. We pray for those who are unnamed at this time that we know. You know who they are. You know what their needs are. And we hold them close in our hearts. Join us again, Lord Jesus. Come to us. Be born in us as we pray together with you. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let us be reminded of Christ's presence with us in the wounded places of the world as we sing together, Wounded World That Cries for Healing. Thank you. The words of this hymn are so powerful in our time. A time when Congress is trying to reach some kind of an agreement to help all of these struggling people in this country find some relief, some assistance, some hope before Christmas and this new year. Wounded systems, bruised and bleeding, bear the load and the scars of strain. Dollars ration out compassion. Hard decisions rule the day. Jesus of the healing spirit, free us to another way. And we remember the doctors and the nurses and the despair that so many of them feel. And we remember another verse of this song. Honor those whose loving spirit nurses hope, restores and heals. Towel and basin used in service, like the Christ who comes and kneels. In the tending, in the mending, may we see the right and fair. And in our common quest for wholeness, heal each other by our care. Receive the blessing. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the all-embracing and never-ending love of God, and the peace and presence of God's Spirit comfort, hold, and lift us now and always. So be it. Amen.